Hi, welcome to our brief stargazing guide for January. In our tour of the night sky, we'll first pick objects that are bright enough to be seen in areas with moderate light pollution, and then we'll proceed to identify related objects like constellations and asterisms. Since such related objects may not be visible in light-polluted skies, this guide is meant to be useful for both viewers in light-polluted areas where the bright objects can be seen, as well as viewers in dark sky areas where the less visible details of the constellations and asterisms can be seen. The illustrations used in this guide have been obtained from Stellarium app, but you can also use Stellarium web to see them. The objects in this guide are in the position they would appear to a viewer located about 50 degrees north of equator between 11 p.m. and midnight in January. In January, the long hours of winter darkness and low humidity in the atmosphere are still working in our favor if you can brave the cold. The beauty of the winter objects is also in full display in the southern sky. In addition, for January 2023, the red planet Mars is still ruling the southern sky as the brightest object for the midnight viewers beside the moon. All we need to hope for is clear sky. We'll do most of our tour in the southern sky, and then at the end we'll turn around and see the position of the circumpolar objects in the northern sky. For this guide, I have picked Gemini, the twins, as our main constellation. By midnight, Gemini will be almost overhead in the southern sky here. In this area, we'll also see constellations Orion, Auriga, Taurus, Canis Major, Canis Minor, Monoceros, Cancer, and Lepus. We'll also see the winter triangle and the winter hexagon asterisms and identify the major stars of the winter sky, including Sirius, Betelgeuse, Rigel, Capella, Aldebaran, and Pollux. In the northern sky, we'll find the main circumpolar objects, including the Big Dipper asterism and the constellations Ursa Major, Ursa Minor, Cassiopeia, Draco, and Cepheus. Let us begin by finding the constellation Gemini, the twins, in the southern sky. We can find Gemini in several ways, but let me share the ones that work best for me. One way is to look directly at the very distinct pair of stars. If we stand facing south and look straight up, it is easy to see a pair of stars that seem to be of similar brightness, close to overhead, looking like this. These stars are Pollux and Castor that mark the heads of the twins. To confirm that you're looking at Pollux and Castor, if you look further up in the rightward direction here, you will see another pair of stars, but these ones are slightly further apart, and the one on the right is much brighter. These are Menkalinan and Capella in the constellation Auriga. If we got them right, connecting them with lines should give us a shape like this. If you're watching from light-polluted sky, you may find it hard to see other stars in the constellation Gemini besides this one down here, which is called Alhena. Another way that I use to find the heads of the twins is to begin with the reddish-bright star in the constellation Orion, the Betelgeuse. It is easy to find Betelgeuse because the three stars forming the Orion's belt can be easily spotted on its lower right side down here. Once you have found Betelgeuse, look for stars in the up leftward direction that you can connect with lines to form an elongated Y shape like this, touching the heads of the twins on one end and Betelgeuse on the other. One more way of finding the heads of the twins is to begin with the star Sirius, which is the brightest star in the night sky, located straight south here. From Sirius, trace a line in the up leftward direction like this, to the next bright star here, which is Procyon. Extending this line further up towards overhead like this will take you to the pair forming the heads of the twins. Pollux is a red giant located about 34 light years away, the closest giant star to us. It is the brightest star in the constellation Gemini. Castor lies 51 light years away. It is the second brightest star in the constellation Gemini, and it is made up of three binary pairs. The next brightest star in the constellation Gemini is Alhena. It lies about 109 light years away and forms the foot of one of the twins. The rest of stars in the constellation Gemini may be hard to see if you're viewing from light polluted area. I will trace the shape of the twins, and if you are in a dark sky area, you can trace with me. The bodies, and their arms. That completes the shape of Gemini, the twins. As you may already know, below the feet of the twins is the constellation Orion, the hunter, looking like this. Above Orion, to the right, is the constellation Taurus, the bull, looking like this. And overhead, between Gemini and Taurus, is the constellation Auriga, looking like this. Remember Sirius down here? It is also known as the dog star and is in the constellation Canis Major, the greater dog accompanying the hunter. The Canis Major constellation looks like this. Marked by Procyon is the Canis Minor constellation, the lesser dog, which together with the greater dog are in a hunting mission with the hunter. Other less visible constellations in this area are Lepus, the hare, which is below the hunter here, Monoceros, the unicorn, between the two dogs here, and Cancer, the crab, which is to the left of Gemini here. Cancer is the fourth zodiac constellation after Gemini and Taurus. Zodiac constellations are those lying along the ecliptic, the path taken by the sun, the moon, and the planets in the sky. To learn more about Orion, Taurus, and Auriga, please watch my previous videos. In January 2023, the planet Mars is still in the constellation Taurus. At the turn of the month, Mars will still be in its retrograde motion that began at the end of October 2022, but will increasingly slow down until 12th January 2023, when it will stop and slowly resume its eastward motion against the background stars. By mid-January, Mars will be approximately located where it is in this illustration. Besides the constellations, other prominent winter objects in the southern sky are the winter triangle asterism, which is made up of the lines connecting the stars Sirius with Procyon, Betelgeuse, and back to Sirius. Another one is the winter hexagon asterism, which we can draw by extending the line from Sirius to Procyon, to Pollux, then Capella, Aldebaran, Rigel, and lastly back to Sirius. See more about this in my previous video. In the constellation Taurus, there are two open star clusters, the Pleiades and the Hyades. And below the Orion's belt is Orion Nebula. Now, let us turn to the northern sky. The easiest object to identify in this part of the sky is the Big Dipper asterism, also known as the Plow asterism, which in January is up to the right here. Once we have found Big Dipper, we can find Polaris, the North Star, by extending the line at this end until it hits the next bright star. If you have done it right, the star we have just hit here is Polaris. Polaris marks one end of the constellation Ursa Minor, the Little Bear, which is also known as the Little Dipper asterism. From this position and time, the shape of Ursa Minor runs in down rightward direction like this. From Polaris, if we draw a line in the leftward direction like this, it will take us to another bright star here, which is part of the five stars forming the constellation Cassiopeia, the Queen. Cassiopeia is easy to find because of its distinct W shape. If you look carefully between Polaris and Cassiopeia, there is a visible star down here and a brighter one further down that you can connect with lines to form a Y shape like this. The star in the middle is called the Alderamin, which is the brightest star in the constellation Cepheus, the King. The rest of stars in this constellation are too dim to be seen from light-polluted areas. Cepheus has a heart-like shape looking like this. The brighter star down here is Deneb, which marks the tail of Cygnus, the Swan. At this time and position, the rest of the Swan is submerged below the horizon. If we look carefully to the right of Deneb, you may be able to see a pair of faint stars here. These stars mark the head of the constellation Draco, the Dragon, which extends like this. The Big Dipper asterism is part of the Ursa Major constellation, the Great Bear, which looks like this. These are the circumpolar objects that appear to rotate counterclockwise around Polaris, which is close to the North Celestial Pole. And that brings us to the end of our tour of the night sky in January. I hope you have found it useful. If so, please like, and do not forget to subscribe if you'd like to see more content like this. I will also appreciate your comments. Thank you for watching.